Kane is in the film.
Welcome to the sports podcast that will put you in the zone all the time. Welcome to Pac Sports Zone with me, your host, Peter Pacman Clarke. What's going on, guys? Another episode of Pac Sports Zone. Baseball today, and we got a lot of stuff to go over as it's been a real busy week in sports and period, and I'll get to that a little bit later, but wanted to get some actual sports talked about really quick. First, congratulations to Lucas Giolito of the White Sox pitching a no-hitter this week. Earlier this week, it was the 19th no-hitter in White Sox history, which is the most by any AL franchise. But it's their first since 2012, so it's been a while. He pitched a great game, struck out 13, only walked one batter. I'll tell you what, if you want to throw a no-hitter, you should just go against the Pirates. They've been no-hit 13 times, so I think that's the most of any franchise. So congratulations to him, good young pitcher. Used to be with the Washington Nationals, but he was involved in the trade, so he is now Chicago White Sox and part of that very young group that we're going to get to later and talk about them in a little bit. Let's get right into the power rankings because I do have some things to talk about later, but let's just get right into it. Number 10, the team that's dropped the most, the New York Yankees, at 16-11 right now. They've lost five in a row. The only person really hitting right now is Luke Voit. He's got 11 home runs. He had a home run in five straight games. That was snapped in game two, the second game of the doubleheader versus the Braves. In the first game, he was the one who provided the only run for the Yankees with a home run off Ian Anderson, who I am also going to be talking about a little bit later. Yankees are really struggling right now. They're not hitting well. They got swept by Tampa Bay. Then they lose the doubleheader to the Braves. They need to find. They were actually saying that after how they played against the Rays, they really wanted to get back in there and play. And then they had the three games that were postponed against the Mets because of COVID-19 with the Met player and staffer. So they really think that really got them out of rhythm. So they need to snap out of it. And it's probably not helping that they're not playing right now. So they need to really get a win just to turn things around for them. Moving to number 9, the Cubs, another team that a couple weeks ago I had them at top at my power rankings, and they've also fallen. They've lost four of their last six. Chris Bryant has been benched a couple games. He's not hitting well. They continue to struggle with hitting overall. I'm not really sure what's wrong with them, to be honest. I mean, the problem is that it's a very short season, so they've got to figure it out fast. The season's half done already. Like I said, they are 18-12. It's only a 60-game season, so the season is half done. And they're very lucky right now that they're in a division where nobody is really challenging them too much. So they know they're going to make the playoffs. So obviously, there's going to be 8 teams in each division, so they're going to get in. But they need to figure out what's going on because they're definitely not playing well. Remember, this was a team that I think was 11-3 at one point, and now they're 18-12. They're really struggling. Speaking of a team that isn't struggling, though, the San Diego Padres, they had a 7-game winning streak. They're back in this top 10 now after 1 week, after falling out for 1 week. They're replacing the Astros, who didn't really deserve to be in the top 10 teams this week. Padres are 19-14, but like I said, they've been on a real hot streak. They've won 8 of their last 10. Fernando Tatis right now, Jr., is playing like a top 5 player in the sport. He is just on fire right now. He's hitting 300 with 12 home runs, 29 RBI, 6 stolen bases. He's just doing it all. And if you watch him, he's just such an exciting player to watch. I mentioned watching him a couple weeks ago when I had the Padres in my initial top 10. And you really got to, if I know the games are late, especially for the East Coasters, but if you can see Fernando Tatis play, you got to get out there and see him. He's one of the young, exciting players in the league. And this is only his second year. He was top 3 in the Rookie of the Year voting with last year with Cunha and everything like that. So he's up there. He's going to be a big-time star. Moving on to the top number 6, number 7, the Atlanta Braves. You know what? The problem with the Braves is, you know what? It's just, I told you, once Soroka got hurt, that just completely killed their momentum. However, their hitting has woken up. They've won 7 of their last 9. They're 18-12, and Ian Anderson gave Braves fans some hope. He's the Braves' top pitching prospect. I think he's 20 years old, maybe 21, but either 20 or 21 years old. And he pitched six innings of one-hit ball versus the Yankees. He gave up that home run to Luke Voit. Other than that, he pitched great. And you know what? They followed up that game in the second game with Max Fried pitching a gem in game two, only giving up a run. If Anderson ends up being the real deal, then you have Soroka next year with Fried, with Anderson, three guys that are top of the top tier young pitching prospects, and you may have your next level of, I mean, you don't want to compare them, but obviously they're going to be compared because of their franchise to Mattis, Glavine, and Smoltz. They can be really top tier pitchers that are all young, all coming up at the same time. So that's the hope that the Braves fans got to hope for right now. Soroka coming back healthy and Anderson being the real deal. Moving into number six, the Minnesota Twins. As I've been saying with them, they're a hard team to really call. They're still 20-12, so they're still having a good record. But they're kind of streaky. It's kind of like they win three in a row, then they lose a couple. Then they win three in a row, then they lose a couple. It's one of the. They may be just who we think they are. They may be just a team that's a playoff team that isn't going to go that far. So I'm not going to waste too much time on them unless they show some more. I don't want to say heart, but give me a streak. Give me a 5-6 game win streak and move up a little bit. Unless they are able to do that, I'm not really going to spend too much more time on them. So let's get to the top five teams. Number five, the Indians have moved into the top five. They're 19-12. They had a 6-game winning streak, and then they had it cooled down for the past week. They've been 3-3. I don't have a big, strong belief in them yet, but I do have a more belief in them than Minnesota, and it's mostly because of their manager, Terry Francona. Tito Francona is one of the best managers in baseball. Respected him so much when he was with the Boston Red Sox, and I kind of look at him the way I look at Mike Scioscia when he was the manager of the Angels. You just have so much respect for him, and you always think that he's going to make the right call. So because of that, I'm going to give the Indians the slight edge over the Twins, but I'm not going to give them the edge over the super hot Chicago White Sox. The White Sox had an 8-game win streak. It did get snapped a couple days ago, but then they picked it right back up with two wins against their cross-town rival, the Cubs. They're just very hot right now, but the question is, how long can they stay this hot? I mean, they're a young team. They're riding the energy of their youthful players, and who knows how long it's going to last. As I said, it doesn't have to last that long. This is only a 60-game season, and we're already halfway through it. So if the energy of those players can keep them going, the White Sox are going to be a dangerous team because you really don't know what they're going to do. You don't know if they're going to choke in the playoffs. You don't know if their energy is going to make them explode in the playoffs. They're a team that you definitely got to watch out for. I remember mentioning them in the preseason on Two Dudes in the Mexican with Vic, and he was telling me to pick out some teams that could be that team to come out of nowhere. And I remember mentioning the White Sox because they have a lot of good, talented young players, and they're starting to blossom right now. Top three of the power rankings move into the Oakland A's. Oakland A's has been one of the top teams in baseball for the past couple weeks so far. They've won six of their last eight and eight of their last 14. They're still trucking along pretty consistently. It's weird because nothing on their team is something they do that is outstanding. Nothing really stands out. But they're just a steady team, and their bullpen is hot right now. Their bullpen is hot, so they're just rolling along. Anytime they get a lead, their bullpen shuts them down and they're good. But they got to get that lead. They play a lot of close games, and their bullpen has been lucky enough to bail them out of those close games. But they've been down. I've watched their games and seen them down 2-1, down 3-2, and their bullpen just holds it just enough so they can score one run or two runs to get that win. So Oakland's one of those teams that just going to keep trucking along all year, and they're going to keep getting disrespected except by me. And we'll see how that works in the playoffs. Number two in the power rankings is the team that was number one last week, the Tampa Bay Rays. Listen, over the past 2.5 weeks, nobody's been hotter than them. They're 15-3 their last 18 games. So, and I'll tell you what, the guy that I've been telling you about that I keep saying that you got to learn his name, Brandon Lowe, the second baseman for the Rays. He has 10 home runs and he's hitting .300, and that's out of nowhere. Like as I said, we're halfway through the season, and he has 10 home runs and he's hitting .300. He doubles this over the season. That means 60 games, he has 20 home runs. That's a great year to have 20 home runs, because that's the equivalent of having about 55 home runs for the whole season. So you got to watch out for this team. I said, and their pitching still has not come around. Charlie Morton still has not rounded into form to be healthy enough to really give them what they want. It's pretty much been on Blake Snell. So if Charlie Morton comes back and he pitches well, this is one of those teams that you really got to watch out for. But number one is a team that, listen, they're the best team in baseball right now. The Los Angeles Dodgers, 24-9. They've won. I said that nobody was harder than the Rays over the last 2.5 weeks. Well, if you cut it down a little bit and just say the last 2 weeks, nobody's been harder than the Dodgers. 13-2 their last 15 games over the last 2 weeks. Betts and Seager both have 11 home runs and 8 home runs respectively, and they're both hitting over 300. Muncy and Bellinger both have 8 home runs, so their power bat has at least woken up a little bit. The only problem with them is they're still only hitting around 200. The staff has fell back a little bit, but with the bats waking up, it really doesn't matter. I mean, like I said, they're the best team in baseball right now, and if them against anybody in the series right now, I'm picking them. So it's the Dodgers' world. It's the Dodgers' World Series to lose. As we've said that a couple times before, we'll see if they can finally get that World Series that they haven't gotten since 1988 when they had Oral Hershiser. So now that I've finished with the top 10, I just wanted to speak a little bit on what's going on in sports overall, not just baseball. I felt the need to say something. I know a couple of you have seen the video of me talking about Roger Goodell when he spoke about some of the social issues that are happening. And with everything that's going on this week, I just wanted to give 5 minutes regarding it. Listen, protests continue right now all the time, social injustice, but they aren't being covered as much. It's being looked at as yesterday's news, you know, and I had a feeling this would happen. And you got to keep going. You got to keep trying to put posts on social media. You got to keep, as the NBA players, they got to keep wearing these shirts and hats and mentioning the people's names, and you have to say their names, you know. And when the NBA were talking about canceling playoffs, I'm not gonna lie, I was torn in many ways. In one way, I think they should stop. You know, what's more of an impact than stopping a season in the middle of the playoffs? Every time you go back and look at who was the 2020 champion, it won't have anything, and it's because of this. Like, you can't have a bigger impact than that. And another way, sports and personally, it's been my escape from stress in life, you know. It's like that with other people. It's just a getaway from everybody's troubles, you know. Everybody talks about mental health, and sports is a big mental health helper towards me and a lot of people out there. I'm mostly torn on what is the most effective way to bring change. Not playing, as I said, would be the biggest impact. It would be the biggest shock impact, maybe even a bigger impact historically. But they lose their platform, and this is something that they need to create their influence. I mean, everybody doesn't have the name power of LeBron James. I mean, when LeBron James speaks, everybody listens. It doesn't matter if you're a basketball fan, if you're a football fan. He's a person that when he says something, everybody's going to listen. Some of these players, they need the attention of the league to give their voice more power. Give you an example, Jaylen Brown of the Boston Celtics, Malcolm Brogdon out there, and George Hill's out there. If they aren't playing basketball, I mean, listen, some people obviously will listen, but most people will not listen to them. They just aren't. I mean, it sounds bad to say, but they need the NBA platform for their voice to have more power. So I can understand them continuing to play, but they've got to make an impact on society. They just can't say it. They have to keep making mentions of it in their press game pressers. I see the WNBA. I see them wearing the shirts. Arrest the cops who killed Breonna Taylor. We also now obviously have to talk about Jacob Blake after what happened this week. We have to talk about the cops who paralyzed him and shot him 7 times in the back when he was unarmed at the time. We have to talk. Listen, I have multiple cop friends, and all of them say the same thing. They say it's all about training, and they say it's about people that really shouldn't be cops. And we know it's a tough job, but we can't just bring everybody off the streets that say they want to be a cop and let them be a cop. We need to make it be a right to be a cop. Make it a privilege, you know? Make it hard to be a cop. We have to give them better training. It's one of those things where, like, past couple of weeks I've seen a lot of people kind of throw money at black businesses and think that's going to do anything. And while that is great, that doesn't solve the issue. This is not a money issue. This is a systematic racism issue from top to bottom. Kneeling isn't going to get it done. And this kind of goes back to Leonard Myers, what he was talking about, where he says Black Lives Matter. And also the kid Isaac from Orlando specifically, actually, because he said that the reason why he stood and the reason why he didn't wear the shirt is because it's not about the shirt. It's not about kneeling. It's about what are you going to do? And that's actually was right. And it goes back to him. And a lot of people bashed him for not kneeling and not wearing the shirt. But what he said is exactly right. Kneeling isn't going to get it done. Kneeling just brought attention to the issue, but kneeling isn't going to solve the issue. Wearing a Black Lives Matter shirt isn't going to get it done. We need actual reform. We need better training. We need higher standards. And that stuff doesn't happen overnight, but we have to start seeing it happen or nothing's going to change. So with that, I just want to get that off my chest, let you guys hear about it a little bit. And listen, guys, it's going to be a good week. It's going to get better. It's been a rough week for sports and for everything, but everything will get better. We'll get back to sports in a couple days. NBA will be back on Saturday. NHL will be back on Saturday. Baseball is still going on. But with that, I will leave you with the Black National Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing, and we will see you guys on Saturday for football. And obviously next week for baseball next Thursday. Peace out, guys.